All right, I'm going to be doing campaign diaries for a campaign of D&D that my friend John is running for me, and other people, obviously. The campaign is called Into the Wildlands. It takes place on a land called Khondarth, which is a new continent that was recently discovered in the past 100 years. It was thought to be a legend, a myth, but swirling fog has dissipated around the continent, and now people are able to go to Khondarth. There are 4 people in the party, myself playing Zemrail, a bard, John, a different John, playing Sagawasa, a monk, Matt playing Kron, a ranger, and Tony playing Milo Webley-Anders, a rogue. Those are the 4 people that are going to be in this campaign. I will be referring to them by their character names. You get used to it. And these campaign diaries are supposed to be letters from my character, Zemrail, from Khondarth back to the old country, I would say, or the older nation. Zemrail is from Anhavia, specifically in a city called Stravgate. Zemrail is under the patronage of a half-elf, Marilia Fallowbane. And so these letters are sent back to her, specifically about what Zemrail finds and sees in Khondarth. Zemrail is trying to find and write the music of Khondarth. They have synesthesia, which is, if you don't know, the ability to kind of hear colors and kind of see music. So Zemrail is going to Khondarth to basically experience what Khondarth is in terms of music and how that affects itself, and is going to be writing musical lyrics and songs to send back to Marilia. Dear Marilia, I have been on the sea for quite some time. There's not been much issue found in traveling the seas. We've not encountered many storms or many beasts at all. The sea is pleasant, but I will be happy to be on land again. There are many interesting people on this ship of ours. One of the most interesting is a Kenku named Kron. Kenku have a marvelous ability to mimic sounds that they've heard. I'm interested in talking more with Kron about this ability. I, as a musician myself, could use something of this nature. It would be most helpful to have the ability to play back music. We've arrived in the city of Felrune. Felrune is quaint, I should say. It's not nearly as extravagant as Stravgate. And for that, I am both relieved but disappointed. I've gotten so used to playing in the areas of Stravgate and the taverns that I don't think any other place will be the same. But it is nice to be away from Anhavia and out of my own. There's only so much that the guild can do for me, but it is nice to be able to try and do stuff on my own. Upon arriving in Felrune, I noticed that Kron was having slight issues communing with the locals, as mimicry makes it hard for one to have their own voice. I decided to, I don't want to say take pity, because Kron does not need pity, but I decided to try and assist Kron in ways that I could. I have a penchant for words, and thought Kron could use my assistance. So I decided to kind of stick with Kron. Kron and I made our way through the city briefly, but then we split up. I went to the inn where I knew that I was going to perform in order to get some lodging. I do not know much of what Kron did. Before it got dark, I went looking for Kron and found him at a blacksmith. We talked with the blacksmith for a little bit and was able to get what we needed from him. Kron had told me about some noises that he heard in the sewer, but I was unable to go at that time because of a prior obligation at the tavern, the Flagrant Flagon. I then told Kron that I would be willing to go with him, but only in the morning. I would have to play first. Kron then agreed and came to the tavern with me. I then performed in the tavern, but midway through my set, a most curious sight happened. A loud noise came from the entranceway. It seems a body had hit the floor. When the body hit the floor, a lot of people came to investigate. Two of the most interesting people were Sagawasa, a apling from the far north. I have never heard of an apling before. I've never even seen one such as he. So that was a very curious thing to see. The other was a folk hero, although I did not know him at the time. He was quite boisterous and insisted that everybody should have heard of him. He, of course, was no other than Milo Webb Leanders. The two investigated the body, and Sagawasa was quick to discern that the body had Crimson Plague. I know that Stravgate has dealt with Crimson Plague in the past, but I do not have much familiarity with it. Very interesting to see something of this nature. Milo and Sagawasa were then able to roll the body out of the... wrapped it in cloth and rolled it out of the inn. Everyone was quite concerned. I tried to clean the area, as is my magical ability. That is when the evening took, I don't want to say a turn, but the depression or a morose sensibility settled over the inn. I have then tried to lift the morose nature that had set over the inn. I played some tunes and listened to Milo talk about the adventures that he had had, specifically in getting the Dagger of Melrose. I then, understanding what Milo was getting at, told a story of my own of Milo's great deeds, albeit I did not know them as true as they should be. After I finished playing and telling the story of Milo, I sat down and talked with Sagawasa and Milo Leanders, and Kron, of course. They were very interested in me. It seems as if they have not seen a tiefling of my nature before. But I can understand that, and coming from Anhavia, Strathgate, would be different. They come from different places, and there are different things in the world. We talked about various things, but eventually it was decided that they would be coming with us to investigate the sewers on the morrow. And we woke and made our way to the sewers. As we made our way down into the sewers, we investigated various paths and passages. We eventually stumbled upon a note talking about various individuals that were trying to, let's say, evade the shining fucks, as they say. They had left some platinum and told of a mark that was further down the tunnels, or the sewers. We investigated more of that area, but upon going where we thought the mark would be, it was blocked by rubble. So we made our way back and investigated some of the other rooms. In one of the rooms, which was very dark, we saw lots of webbing. And as Milo went further in to investigate, he was pinned by a massive spider, which we easily dispatched of. Upon deftly killing the spider, we continued down the path and ran into some kobolds, which, upon retrospect, is what Kron heard the other day. So, we talked with the kobolds a bit about what they'd been doing down here, and it seems as if they have just been living down here, so we left them be. Upon further investigation of the sewers, we found a ritual room. It had a dais upon it with a very old cloth, and this cloth had various symbols on it. I was not able to copy them directly, but I will include some in case they will be of use to you. Upon dealing with the cloth and the dais, we did not end up figuring out what it was for. We made our way to a busted-through wall in the sewer. It looks like the sewers led into where there was a well. Well, this was concerning to us, of course, because the contamination from the sewer and any sort of individual that could have come through would have been very dangerous. So we made our way closer to the well and talked with a melon monger above us, and then were accosted by a ochre jelly. This jelly was ferocious, but we were able to dispatch that as well as we were the spider. We believe that the ochre jelly had been sitting on top of the well, kind of leaching some of itself into the well water, poisoning it. We then took some of this water and made our way back up to the city proper. We gave this ill water to the head of the Lightbringers, the head being Navara. Navara was, how shall I put it, was receptive to the fact that this ochre jelly may have been poisoned in the water, but was far less receptive to the fact that we were asking for payment. Specifically, I was, and I can bet you understand why. As coming from Javia, there is a certain need for payment. As an entertainer, I expect to be paid for the services that are rendered. We were then chastised about taking away healing from the people that lay in the cots that were sick in front of us, but I persisted, and two healing potions were given to us. We made our way out, and Kron's heart of gold managed to come back, and he was able to convince us to give one of the potions back to Navara. After we finished with Navara, we made our way back down into the sewers. Actually, not the sewers. We continued on the path of where we thought the mark would be, about a quarter mile off of the western tunnel. As we made our way to the western part of the sewer, we actually looked down over the cliffside of Felruin and saw that there was a third level beneath the sewer. So we made our way down into this third level, and it was ruins. But these ruins were far older than anything I would have seen, or have seen before. They must have been at least 1,000 years old. This is before anything of the old country of Enhavia or the League would have sent over. That is troubling to me. In investigating this barracks or kitchen, the tables were made of stone or metal. There was no wood or any sort of cloth. We started investigating, and I lit a fire in the fireplace, and upon doing so, we were accosted by three ghouls. These ghouls, as you may have guessed, proved no match for the four of us. We were able to take them down, with only minor damage to ourselves. We were able to keep each other healthy and well. We then investigated more of the room, looking for various passages and other rooms. We found a very interesting circumstance, I would say, that one of the doorways was blocked off. We then knocked on the door and a voice responded. This voice was none other than Chiron. That would mean nothing to you, but now it means a great deal to me. Kyren said that he was in this room for who knows how long, that he had no memory of being in this room. He's been there as long as he could remember. We thought that was strange, but decided to let it go. We gave Kyren a sword and asked him to come with us. As we investigated more of the area, we became less and less trusting of Kyren. It seemed as if he was lying about his memory. Something was off to us. We came down a long hallway and saw a barricaded room. Upon getting to the barricaded room, we tried to convince Kyren to be the first to enter the room, but he declined. At this point, we had taken his sword from him and were very not trusting. Kron shoved Kyren through the barricade into the room. I then rushed in after trying to tie his hands. What we noticed in the room was very peculiar. It was like the dais that we had seen in the eastern part of the sewers, but on this dais was an orb. And then as soon as we came into the room, the candles around the dais lit, and the orb started to emanate a black smoke, and we knew we were in danger. I tried to tie up Kyren as fast as I could, but I was unable to. We then attacked the orb with all our might, but were not able to kill it, and seeing how powerful the orb could be, it did quite a lot of damage to Sagawasa. We made our way back through the way that we had come, retreating, all kind of holding our spells or arrows, what have you, or knives for Milo Webb Leanders. After we had left Kyren in the room, because we were unable to tie him up and get him to leave in the way that we had wanted, he was thrown out of the room by some force, but the orb didn't follow. Kyren ran past us, and I thought better of it and did not attack him. But upon leaving my view, Kron made a decision and attacked Kyren. Kyren then tried to retreat, but was surrounded by myself, Sagawasa, and Kron. We all then decided it was prudent to make sure that Kyren did not go anywhere. We then tied Kyren up and made sure that he was unable to escape. Milo and I investigated the rest of the tunnels, making sure to not go back into the room where the seer was. We do not know what had happened to it, but it did not leave the room, so we did not press the investigation. We found other doorways that looks like they had also been hiding people, but they had been broken in by the ghouls. Or at least my thought is, whatever it is, these three people, or four people, including Kyren, interacted with the orb and something happened to them. I believe one of them was transformed into a ghoul, and the other three hid. The ghoul then found where one of them was hiding, broke it down, and transformed the other into the ghoul. Those two then found the third and did the same. They were trying to do the same to Kyren, but were unsuccessful. So they sat bashing on the door, but were unable to break in. Milo and I continued investigating, and we found a stairway going up to where the sewers would be, but the stairway was blocked by rubble, so we were unable to go that way. We then came back down to find that Kyren was gone. It seems he had killed himself. He told Kron and Sagawasa to burn the book that they had found on his body, and to kill him. They had tied him up, but he managed to swing himself out over the cliff and fall to his death. Or at least so it seems. We do not know if he is actually dead. This orb may have done something powerful to him. I'm going to assume he is dead for now, until proven otherwise. We then looked about this book, but this book was a black, dark book full of writing and rituals that none of us could understand. We took the book back up to Felorin, and we were not trusting of Navara based upon our previous reception, so we took it to a priestess of Mystra, Yuldra. Yuldra was able to, don't want to say she was helpful, but she was able to look at the book for us. We gave it to her for safekeeping for the evening so she could investigate it. We then went to the inn where I performed again, and we rested for the evening. In the morning, we went to the Church of Mistra and found Yoldra. She said that the book was full of dark, dark magic, and while she was investigating it, it turned to shadows and evaporated. That was most concerning for us. We were very concerned about the happenings of the book disappearing. We were hoping the book was going to be able to give us some information about the orb that we had fought. We made our way back down to the orb, made a barricade, and attacked it. We were unable to defeat it again, and then Kron came upon a brilliant idea. So we went back up to Felruin, rested for the evening, and procured supplies to make a bomb. Our bomb needed to be able to be rolled in, so we ended up choosing livestock. We chose a pig to act as our vector, I should say. The oils and keg of whiskey were placed onto the pig, and we managed to usher the pig into the room and set it ablaze, and a massive explosion happened, damaging the orb, and we were able to defeat it. It was very close and very dangerous. Sakawasa was almost killed, and I myself was almost killed, but nonetheless, we were able to kill the orb, whatever it was, and it is no more. We made our way back up to Felruin proper, trying to see if we could find another way into the sewers, but it seems as we had run that course. We were then found by a lightbearer who said that Navara was looking for us. We made our way back to Navara and told her about what we had done beneath the city. She said that the note probably was from a cult that had landed in Felruin and was trying to make it their own, but were unable to fully live here, so they had to adapt. She said that she was going after them for quite some time, at least the past 10 years. And it seems as if we had finished her mission. What Nivara had actually wanted to tell us was the White Warden, Bracken, on the far east side of town, actually had been looking for mercenaries, as she had called us, which Milo disagreed with and wanted to be called adventurers. I'm an entertainer. Names are names. They achieved the same objective. So, a mercenary, adventurer, an entertainer, what have you. We made our way, after finishing with Navara, about talking with whatever this sphere was and dealing with the ghouls. She said that she was possibly going to investigate what had happened down there. We were unable to find anything in the room. It seems as if we may have blown it up, but alas, that is okay. We will eventually figure out what was with this orb and what rituals were around it. We then tried to persuade Nivara to compensate us for the deeds done, but she was more reluctant than previous. So we made our way to the White Warden, Bracken. Bracken said that she was looking for mercenary types to help her with a very specific endeavor. The Siphon Guild, further south, had been investigating the legends of Myriald Stormbreaker. Stormbreaker was one of the first people to land on Kondar. We were to look for a very specific fortress, I would say, that Myriald had been looking for as well. The Siphon Guild believes that they're on the right track to find it. There was another thing that Bracken had for us. Three people in town had gone missing in at least the past 2 weeks. She asked us to go investigate north of the city into the forest. She stressed that we do not go and stay in the forest, as it's a dangerous place. We decided to take both of the tasks that Bracken had asked us to do. We decided to deal with the missing people first, as that was a closer objective. We would make our way south when this was resolved. We decided to rest for the evening and then make our way into the forest. Kron, being an excellent tracker, was able to find where the people had been taken. We found a very curious cave. It looks like it was actually carved. Actually, it was probably more of a actual ruin, which is concerning to say the least. We made our way into the ruin and found ourselves in the middle of a trap. Not our brightest move, but we survived. Upon making our way into the trap, we were confronted by a number of goblins. We all kind of scattered and made our way to try and protect ourselves. Kron made his way further down the long tunnel in the ruin. As he moved forward, he was actually confronted by a very dangerous sight. There were, I want to say direwolves, but they were bigger and nastier than any direwolf I've ever heard about. Maybe they were direwolves. These direwolves were released from their cages and came face to face with Kron, but Kron somehow was able to talk them down in some way, and was able to convince them that they should attack the goblins, not us. And so they did, and murdered them with a frenzy. It was quite a sight to behold. We then finished the remaining goblins, and having made peace with the wolves, decided to heal the wolves before sending them on their way. We sent the wolves with a passing respect between the two parties, and we found prisoners locked up, and well, that is all we have accomplished so far. I will write to you more, hopefully. This should probably only be the first of many to come. Okay, that is where we stopped last week. So I am hoping to record these and post them on Sundays. We play D&D on Tuesday. This is gonna be one long video, but from here on it should be about session reports. Each video should be a single session, and I'm gonna go from there. So I'm gonna leave links down. Now I like missed my mark and I was like over here. I'm gonna leave links down below that basically are to the DM John's World Anvil, so you guys can read the world if you want to, and various things. I may be able to find a way to post our character sheets in PDF form. I don't know how to do that. Maybe if that's something that you want to see, what spells we have, what kind of abilities, what our stats are, leave a comment and I will double check and see about that. If you think this is fun, great. I'm gonna keep doing it pretty much regardless, because it's a fun way to catalog the game. So I hope you enjoyed. I hope that the other party members think that I did an okay job. So hopefully I'm going to record more and get more stuff on this channel. Thanks.